Welcome to my video tutorial on gross anatomy of rectum. We will be looking into the following objectives for this topic: general features of rectum, relations and its supports, structure and interior of the rectum, blood supply, nerve supply, lymphatic drainage and few applied aspects. So let's start learning. Rectum, it's a retroperitoneal midline structure seen more posteriorly in the pelvic cavity. It is the lower dilated part of large gut. It is devoid of tinea coli, sacculations and appendices epiploicae, which are the characteristic features of colon. They are absent in rectum. Rectum means a straight tube. However, it is misnamed in humans. When it is viewed from laterally, it shows a forward bend at anorectal junction. So it is not a straight tube in humans. Measurements of rectum. It is 12 cm in length. In the upper part, it shows 4 cm breadth, and in the lower part, it is dilated to form rectal ampulla. When the rectum is empty, it shows a horizontal or transverse lumen on cross-section. Course of the rectum. Rectum lies in front of sacrococcygeal curve. It begins at rectosigmoid junction in front of third sacral vertebra. Below, at the tip of coccyx, it passes downwards and forwards. Then abruptly it turns downwards and backwards till anorectal junction, which lies 2 to 3 cm in front and below the tip of coccyx. From there, it continues below as anal canal. In males, anorectal junction corresponds with apex of prostate gland. So the rectum begins at rectosigmoid junction against third sacral vertebra and ends at anorectal junction, which lies 2 to 3 cm below and in front of tip of coccyx. As the name suggests, rectum is not a straight tube in humans. It shows few curvatures, anteroposteriorly and bilaterally. Anteroposterior curves of rectum are two in number. They are above sacral curve, which has convexity backwards. Below perineal curve, which has convexity forwards. Perineal curve of rectum is seen towards anorectal junction. It is maintained by puborectal sling, which is a muscular sling formed by puborectalis muscle fibers of levator ani muscle or pelvic diaphragm. Lateral curves of rectum, they are three in number, two on right side, one on left side. They are upper curve, which has convexity towards right side, lies at the junction of third and fourth sacral vertebrae. Middle curve, which has convexity towards left side, it lies at sacrococcygeal junction. Lower curve, which has convexity towards right side, it lies at the level of tip of coccyx. So the curvatures of rectum are anteroposterior curves and lateral curves. Anteroposterior curves are above sacral curve and below perineal curve. Lateral curves are upper and lower right curves and middle left curve. Coming to the relations of rectum, they should be studied as peritoneal relations and visceral relations. Peritoneal relations of rectum. Posteriorly, rectum is not covered by peritoneal layer. It is non-peritoneal. It is related with few retroperitoneal spaces, which lie between the sacrum, coccyx and posterior surface of rectum. Anteriorly, only upper two-thirds of the rectum is covered by visceral peritoneum. From there, it reflects anteriorly onto pelvic viscera. In males, It reflects onto superior surface of the urinary bladder and forms a peritoneal pouch known as rectovesical pouch, which lies 7.5 centimeters above the anus. Whereas in females, it reflects onto posterior surface of vagina and uterus to form a peritoneal pouch known as rectouterine pouch or pouch of Douglas, the bottom of which lies 5.5 centimeters above the anus. On each side, only the upper one-third of lateral surfaces of rectum are covered by visceral layer of peritoneum. From there, the peritoneal layers reflects onto lateral pelvic walls and they form deep peritoneal fossae called as pararectal fossae. Visceral relations of rectum. Anterior relations differ in males and in females. In the upper part, where the rectum is covered by peritoneal layer, it is related with sigmoid colon and few coils of small intestine in males as well as in females. Whereas in the lower part, the rectal ampulla, which is non-peritoneal, in males it is related with base of urinary bladder with seminal vesicles, ampullae of ductus deferens, posterior surface of prostate gland. These structures are separated from rectal ampulla by rectovesical fascia of Denon-Villiers. Whereas in females, the rectal ampulla is related with posterior vaginal wall from which it is separated by an ill-defined rectovaginal fascia. Posterior visceral relations. Posteriorly, rectum is related with few bones, ligaments, muscles, vessels and nerves. Bones are lower three pieces of sacrum and coccyx. Ligaments are anococcygeal raphe, which is formed by the muscle fibers of levator ani. It extends from tip of coccyx to anorectal junction. It is covered by a fascia called as Valdeus fascia, which is formed by thickening of pelvic fascia. Muscles are piriformis, coccygeus and levator ani muscle fibers. Vessels are median sacral vessels, lateral sacral vessels, superior rectal artery, which is a branch of internal iliac artery. Nerves related are sympathetic trunks. Below they unite to form ganglion impar, which lies in front of coccyx. Few pelvic splanchnic nerves and lower part of sacral plexus. Lateral visceral relations. In upper one-third, rectum is related with pararectal fossae. They contain sigmoid colon and few coils of small intestine. In middle one-third, it is related with pelvirectal spaces and levator ani muscles. Pelvirectal space contains fat, which is traversed by middle rectal artery and lateral ligament of rectum. The lateral rectal ligament is nothing but thickening of pelvic fascia, which extends from lateral pelvic wall to middle one-third of lateral surface of rectum. In lower one-third, rectum is related with ischiorectal fossae and their contents. So that is about the relations of rectum, which should be studied as peritoneal and visceral relations, which differ in males and in females only anteriorly. Posteriorly, rectum is related with bones, ligaments, muscles, vessels and nerves. Bilaterally, it is related with few fat-filled fossae with their contents. Let's see the supports of rectum. Muscular support is being puborectal sling of levator ani muscle. It maintains the anorectal flexure or perineal curve of rectum. ligamentous support is being lateral ligaments of rectum. They are nothing but thickening of pelvic fascia. They anchor the rectum onto lateral pelvic walls. The muscular and ligamentous supports are the major supports for rectum. The other supports are fascia of Valdeyer. It covers the anacoccygeal raphe on which rectum rests posteriorly. Reflection of pelvic fascia from its visceral layer to parietal layer around the rectum and pelvirectal fat, ischiorectal fat. They act as loose packing materials around the rectum and provide cushion effect. These supports of rectum not only maintain the position of the rectum in the pelvic cavity, but also they maintain the curvatures of rectum. Moving on to structure of rectum. Wall of the rectum is composed of four layers. From outside to inside, they are serous coat. It is formed by peritoneal layer, which incompletely covers the rectum only in its upper two-thirds. Deep to that, muscular coat. It is formed by smooth muscle fibers. They are arranged in two layers, outer longitudinal layer and inner circular layer. Further details about muscular coat we will see in a minute. Deep to that, submucous coat. It is formed by loose connective tissue, blood vessels, nerve fibers and few lymphatics. The innermost layer is mucous coat. It has further three layers. From outside to inside, they are muscularis mucosa, which is composed of smooth muscle fibers, lamina propria, which is composed of loose connective tissue and blood vessels. The innermost surface epithelium, which is formed by simple columnar epithelium with goblet cells. The epithelium dips into the underlying lamina propria to form intestinal glands or crypts of Lieberkuhn. Few details about muscular coat of the rectum. Smooth muscle fibers of the rectum are arranged in two layers, outer longitudinal and inner circular layer. Outer longitudinal layer is thin on the sides of the rectum, whereas it is thick anteriorly, posteriorly to form anterior and posterior thick bands. They are longitudinal bands, continuous above with the muscle fibers of tenia coli. Anterior thick band continuous with tenia libera and tenia omentalis. Posterior thick band continuous above with the tenia mesocolica. Below, the longitudinal muscle fibers are continuous with puborectalis fibers of levator ani muscle. Let's understand this by looking at this image. Here is the outer longitudinal layer. Here is the inner circular layer of the rectum. Here is the levator ani with its puborectalis part, which fuses with the outer longitudinal muscle fibers of the rectum and forms conjoint fibroelastic sheath towards the wall of the anal canal. It separates the internal and external anal sphincters. Coming to the inner circular layer, below it is continuous with internal anal sphincter within the wall of anal canal. So the points to be understood in structure of the rectum are: smooth muscle fibers of the rectum are arranged in two layers, outer longitudinal and inner circular layers. Outer longitudinal muscle fibers form anterior and posterior thick bands. They are continuous above with the tenia coli and below with the puborectalis muscle fibers of levator ani. They form conjoint fibroelastic sheath into the wall of anal canal. Inner circular layer muscle fibers are continuous below with the internal anal sphincter of wall of the anal canal. Moving on to interior of rectum. Here is the sagittal section of pelvic region. Here is the interior of rectum, which shows few mucosal folds Such folds are classified into two types, temporary and permanent mucosal folds. Temporary mucosal folds are longitudinal folds seen in the lower part of the rectum. They disappear when the rectum is distended, whereas permanent mucosal folds are horizontally placed semilunar shaped mucosal folds. They do not disappear when the rectum is distended. They are also called as Houston's valves. They are formed by reduplication of mucous membrane along with submucosa and inner circular layer of wall of the rectum. They are seen along the concavities of lateral curves of the rectum, which means they lie on the opposite wall of corresponding lateral curve. They support the weight of feces when the person is in upright position. Few details about Houston's valves. They are four in number and they are numbered from above downwards. First valve lies at rectosigmoid junction. Remaining three valves are seen along the concavities of corresponding lateral curves of the rectum, which means they lie on the opposite wall of the lateral curve. As they are semilunar shaped valves, they are seen either on the right wall or the left wall of the rectum. First and third valves are fixed in their position, which is why they are called as constant valves, whereas second and fourth valves show variations in their position, which is why they are called as inconstant valves. Further details about individual Houston's valves. First valve lies at rectosigmoid junction opposite to the third sacral vertebra. It arises usually from the left side of the wall of rectum. It can be approached 12 to 14 centimeters from the anal orifice. Second valve arises from left side of the wall of rectum opposite to the upper lateral curve along the concavity. It lies 2.5 centimeters above the third valve and the distance may vary, which makes it inconstant valve. Third valve, it is the most fixed valve of the rectum, lies opposite to the fifth sacral vertebra, arises from right side of the wall of rectum along the concavity of middle lateral curve. It can be approached 5 centimeters above the anal orifice. Occasionally, the semilunar valve may become circular, encircling the wall of the rectum and acts as a sphincter within the lumen of rectum. In such condition, the valve is known as Nellerton's sphincter. Third valve carries an importance as it divides the interior of rectum into two chambers, upper chamber and lower chamber, which differ in their development and function. When the fecal matter reaches the upper chamber, there will not be reflex act of defecation. But when it reaches the lower chamber, there will be spontaneous defecation through reflex act. Coming to the fourth valve, which arises from the left side of the wall of rectum along the concavity of lower lateral curve. It lies 2.5 centimeters below the third valve. The distance may vary, which makes the fourth valve inconstant. So within the interior of rectum, there are mucosal folds, temporary and permanent. Temporary folds are seen in the lower part of the rectum. They are longitudinal folds and disappear when the rectum distends. Permanent folds are horizontal semilunar folds, also called as Houston's valves. They are four in number from above downwards. First and third valves are fixed or constant valves, whereas second and fourth valves are inconstant valves. Now it's time to see the arterial supply of the rectum. Here is the posterior view of rectum. Here is the abdominal aorta dividing into two common iliac arteries, which further divides into external and internal iliac arteries. Internal iliac artery divides into anterior and posterior divisions. Most of the pelvic viscera receives their arterial supply from anterior division of internal iliac arteries. Rectum receives 5 rectal arteries. They are 1 superior rectal artery, 2 middle rectal arteries, and 2 inferior rectal arteries. Superior rectal artery is the principal artery of the rectum. It is the continuation of inferior mesenteric artery, which in turn is a branch of abdominal aorta. Superior rectal artery runs on the posterior surface of the rectum, where it divides into right and left branches, which further divides into number of branches and pierce the wall of the rectum. They reach the submucosal coat of the rectum, where they form arterial plexus. From the plexus, straight-coast arteries arise and they descend into the wall of anal canal. At the level of pectinate line of the anal canal, these branches anastomose with the branches of inferior rectal arteries. Superior rectal artery and its branches supply upper part of the rectum and the entire mucous membrane within the interior of rectum. Coming to the middle rectal arteries, they are the branches of anterior divisions of internal iliac arteries. Each middle rectal artery runs through pelvirectal space along with the lateral ligaments of rectum and reach the lateral surface of the rectum, where they divide into different branches and supply the lower part of the rectum. Inferior rectal arteries, they are the branches of internal pudendal arteries, which in turn branches of anterior divisions of internal iliac arteries. Inferior rectal arteries run through the ischiorectal fossae, reach the anal canal, where they supply anal sphincters and perianal skin. Branches of inferior rectal arteries anastomose with the branches of superior rectal arteries at the level of pectinate line. Basically, rectum is supplied by superior and middle rectal arteries. When these arteries get blocked, inferior rectal arteries supply the rectum through the anastomosis. Let's see the venous drainage of the rectum. Veins draining the rectum and anal canal form venous plexuses around the walls of rectum and anal canal. Such circular venous plexuses are called as annulus hemorrhoidalis. They are divided into two sets, internal venous plexus and external venous plexus. From these plexuses, 5 rectal veins arise and drain the rectum as well as anal canal. They are 1 superior rectal vein, 2 middle rectal veins, and 2 inferior rectal veins. Let's see further details about these venous plexuses and rectal veins. Internal venous plexus. It is the submucosal venous plexus, lies between the mucous membrane and internal anal sphincter. It surrounds the anorectal junction. From its upper part, radical veins arise, run through the submucosal coat of lower part of the rectum, and they unite to form superior rectal vein. Below, the plexus communicates with the external venous plexus through communicating veins. External venous plexus. It surrounds the anal orifice and lies between the perianal skin and external anal sphincter. Laterally, it gives rise to inferior rectal veins, and above it communicates with internal venous plexus through communicating veins. Superior rectal vein. Here it is. It is formed by radical veins which arise from upper part of internal venous plexus. They run through the submucosal coat of the rectum. On the posterior wall of the rectum, they unite to form superior rectal vein. Superior rectal vein pierces the posterior wall of the rectum 7.5 cm above the anal orifice. From there, it accompanies the superior rectal artery and continues with or drains into inferior mesenteric vein, which belongs to portal system of veins. middle rectal veins. Here they are. They directly arise from the middle part of internal venous plexus. They run through the pelvirectal space and drains into internal iliac veins, which belong to vena cava system. Inferior rectal veins, here they are. They arise from the external venous plexus, pass through the ischiorectal fossae and drain into internal pudendal veins, which belong to vena cava system or systemic veins. Let's have a look at the importance of rectal veins. They are the sites of communication between portal and systemic veins, as the superior rectal vein opens into portal system, whereas middle and inferior rectal veins open into vena cava system. They communicate at venous plexuses. Superior rectal vein radicals are devoid of valves and they are surrounded by loose connective tissue. When there is portal hypertension due to portal vein block, there will be raised venous pressure in the superior rectal vein, which causes dilatation of radicals of superior rectal vein. As the superior rectal vein pierces the posterior wall of the rectum, in chronic constipation, during prolonged straining at defecation, causes obstruction of superior rectal vein where it pierces the posterior wall of rectum, causing backflow of the blood into the radicals of superior rectal vein. As they are devoid of valves, they likely get distended. Let's quickly revise the venous drainage of rectum. Veins draining the rectum and anal canal form circular venous plexuses within their walls, called as annulus hemorrhoidalis. Such venous plexuses are two sets, internal and external venous plexuses. Internal venous plexus surrounds anorectal junction. External venous plexus surrounds anal orifice. From the upper part of internal venous plexus, radicals arise and they unite on the posterior wall of the rectum to form superior rectal vein, which drains into portal system of veins. From the middle of internal venous plexus, two middle rectal veins arise and they drain into internal iliac veins, which belongs to vena cava system. From the external venous plexus, two inferior rectal veins arise and they drain into internal iliac veins, which belong to vena cava system. All the rectal veins communicate at internal venous plexus, that is at anorectal junction, which is why it is one of the sites of portocaval anastomosis. So that is about the blood supply of rectum. Arteries supplying the rectum are 5 in number. Superior rectal artery is being principal artery of the rectum. Veins draining the rectum are 5 in number, which accompany the arteries, but they drain into different systems. Superior rectal vein drain into portal circulation. Middle and inferior rectal veins drain into systemic circulation, making anorectal junction one of the sites of portocaval anastomosis. Nerve supply of rectum. Rectum is innervated by autonomic nerve fibers. Sympathetic fibers are derived from superior hypogastric plexus, which is controlled by L1 and L2 spinal cord segments. They act as vasomotors and inhibit the peristalsis of rectal musculature. Parasympathetic fibers are derived from pelvic splanchnic nerves. They form plexus around the rectum, controlled by S2, S3, S4 spinal cord segments. They act as secretomotor and stimulate the peristalsis of rectal musculature. Such nerve supply of the rectum makes the mucous membrane sensitive to differentiate between feces and flatus within the rectum by the tension of rectal wall. Lymphatic drainage of the rectum. Lymph channels draining the rectum form submucous and intramuscular lymphatic plexuses. From there, they drain into different groups of lymph nodes which accompany the arteries. Lymphatics from the upper part of the rectum accompany the superior rectal artery and drain into left common iliac lymph nodes. Lymphatics from the middle part of the rectum accompany the middle rectal arteries and drain into internal iliac lymph nodes. Lymphatics from the lower part of the rectum, few pass above the levator ani muscle and few pass below the levator ani muscle. From there, they pass through the pudendal canal and finally drains into internal iliac lymph nodes. Basically, lymph channels from the rectum drain into left common iliac lymph nodes and internal iliac lymph nodes. Now it's time to see the applied aspects. Per rectal examination, it's a digital examination of rectum and anal canal where the patient is kept in knee chest position. An index finger fitted with a rubber glove is introduced into the lower part of the rectum through anal orifice. Structures can be palpated through the rectal walls are anteriorly in males, base of the urinary bladder with seminal vesicles, ductus deferens, ureters, posterior surface of the prostate gland, bulb of penis with spongy urethra. In females, posterior vaginal wall and uterus. Posteriorly, sacrococcygeal curve, sacral lymph nodes if they are enlarged. On each side, structures on the lateral pelvic walls, pelvic lymph nodes if they are enlarged. In females, broad ligaments of uterus, uterine tubes, and ovaries. Pararectal examination is used as diagnostic tool in various abdominopelvic diseases. Tenderness along the right lateral wall of the rectum during pararectal examination suggestive of inflamed appendix. In chronic constipation due to prolonged straining at defecation, there will be compression of superior rectal vein where it pierces the posterior wall of rectum. It leads to distension of radical veins in the lower part of the rectum. Such dilated tortuous varicose veins are known as hemorrhoids or piles. Fecal incontinence or bowel incontinence, it is defined as inability to maintain the peristaltic movements of the gut so that there will be leakage of feces. It can be neurological or weakening of anorectal ring, which is formed by puborectalis muscle fibers and anal sphincters. Surgical incision of anorectal ring also may lead to fecal incontinence because of loss of anorectal flexure. Prolapse of rectum. It can be incomplete or complete depending on the layers of its wall involved. It is usually due to weakening of muscular and ligamentous supports of the rectum. Here is the end of this video with all the objectives related to rectum. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.